I'm Yodok Batlok. I'm running a company named Lovely Systems, and I'll tell you today a little bit about searching, about what we're doing. As you might see from the first slide, I am from Austria. You know, Austria is famous for cows, but also for girls. I stayed in Berlin for quite some time. That was 3 years ago. I was the CTO of StudiVZ at these times. Nowadays, the traffic is not so big there anymore, but at the time I stayed with the guys, we were the biggest German-speaking website. Now I'm back at my own company, as I said, Lovely Systems. And our prototype, or a little bit also my admire, Mr. Vincent Wolf, because if you got a corpse in a car, minus a head, take me to it. We really love solving big problems or large data, a lot of traffic. So last year, Searchmetrics, a Berlin-based company, approached us, and they're having a large amount of data. They do analysis of have a link database with millions or billions of links in there. They have a lot of crawlers out there where they're tracking SEO features, and they also have a suite where they are working with social data, not just about retweets, but also more in the area of sentiments and things like that. So we're working together with them, also supporting their own engineering. And in these projects, we were working on analysis, especially on Twitter, but also on other social networks. So, yeah, we came there, took out the knife. Working also in an iterative approach. That means, come on. Okay, doesn't work anymore, which is not really good. Here we go. So the next slide, probably it's gonna take a little bit longer until it flips again. I want to say we were working in an iterative approach where you, come on. Okay, it skipped the slide. Somehow we came to here. Iterative approach, that means we just start with a very small prototype. Was sure we were doing the first mock-up with Amazon EC2 because it's pretty simple to work. It's also we're doing a lot of stuff with EC2. I always in presentations need to show this screenshot because it says on the Amazon blog in 2006 that Lovely Systems is using Amazon. So we were since 6 years, and we were looking at the tweets. Anatomy of a tweet is not just simple text of 140 characters, but it's a more complex thing. You have the creation date, you have the author's location, you have screen name, you have a lot of different stuff. And it came quick. We came pretty quick to the point that we knew we're gonna use Elasticsearch. I'm not using the full text stuff of Elasticsearch, as Schaefer mentioned before. We're just using it as document store. That means a lot of Lucene things that are powerful, like stemming or language specific stuff. We're not using it at all. We're using it as a pure document store. So we started at the beginning, just as you usually do. We had a bunch of terabytes of log files from crawlers. We did with find, with setcat, with curl, and we're just pushing the stuff into the pretty large instances, M2x large instances, and had two replicas, and we're working with it. It turned out pretty fast that this approach didn't really scale very well, because it was like this single instance had to drive all that, and it was just busy with Zcat and also pushing it to an Elasticsearch. So we added Hadoop to the game, and used MapReduce to push the data to Elasticsearch. That means on every node was a MapReduce instance. That MapReduce instance was accessing the data and pushing it into an Elasticsearch, so we hadn't the bottleneck anymore. At the beginning, we were using NFS, but that turned out pretty fast that it didn't work out. And we switched to HDFS. But then we also got hit pretty hard. It didn't work at all. Disk I/O was absolutely not enough. We had never enough disk I/O on all the machines. It turned out that when we were using the HDFS with zipped files, that the zip reader was not able to read concatenated files. You would have need a version beta something patched of Hadoop. Compression with gzip was okay, but if you want to convert it to another compression format, such as bzip2 or just something simpler, then it turned out that we didn't have enough compute power just to all the time zip and unzip all the files. Then we also had the problem that we were also part of it in one availability zone. We lost some of the data on the EBS volume, so we had also to take care about different availability zones. We were also struggling with problems with the tweets. So here you see we were also doing some experiments with the streaming API of Twitter on how to get the tweets, but sometimes you got cut off or you lose data. So this was a pretty hard stuff, and we just re-engineered the entire storage architecture and the way we collected data. So we came up with Hadoop storage, where we had six nodes that were on all the time. A name node, a job tracker, and one instance for Hive. I'll come to Hive later. Put in 3 terabytes in each node, created 3 replicas through all the 3 availability zones, and had this as base storage for all the data that has been was collected. And we were spinning up spot instances to fill Elasticsearch as needed. We were trying some experiments to use S3 with external tables on Hive. Don't try this. At least for us, it didn't work very well. It also turned out, as soon as you do this CP from S3 with the S3FS, then it was not running really stable. So we stayed to the normal approach where it puts everything in a HDFS. And it also turned out that the storage part was not the most expensive part of it. We started with Beanstalk and played around with other automation tools. Finally, we came to the point where we were just using some more Bash to start up Elasticsearch instances. It turned out that 5 instances were not really enough, and also for the spot instances. So we just had a script that was launching the instances with Puppet. The cloud in it is pretty handy because you can pass a YAML file to the instance that is being fired up as user data, and then the instance is configuring itself. So that is really simple. It's no magic. It's just a simple cloud in it. We also made sure that the hosts always get the same keys because it was the point we were stopping and starting instances all the time because we had to try the configuration. How much storage, how much memory, the M1 large instance or the X large instance, 20 of them or 30 of them or 10 of them. And so we just had all the times the same HSH keys. The instance was started, connected directly to Puppet, configured itself, and was added to the cluster. So that was the time where we got hit again. As the storage was really working, it was stable. The experiments with Elasticsearch were pretty hard because we always had not enough I/O. We had about 6 terabytes of data we put into Elasticsearch that were about that time 10 billion of documents, and we also had troubles with the memory backing up the replicas. And we also hit the Amazon Web Services limits quite some time. If you start with the best job, 100 instances, then you got blocked by Amazon. You need to call them so they unblock you, so you can't start more instances. But then you need to, later, you can't delete block volumes. It's not possible to delete 100 EBS volumes within 5 minutes. So you need to call again to raise the limits. Finally, we're at the point where we had it running, and it turned out that the EBS was the big problem. If you have 100 EBS volumes or something like that, you always have one or two of them that are slow. I never noticed this before the 5 years before we were using EBS, but if you read the blogs and things like that, you notice that some of the EBS volumes, they take a long access time. And when we do indexing in Elasticsearch and we had 30 nodes and we were just randomly writing the data to them, so all of them were writing in parallel, it turned out that the cluster was as slow as the slowest node, because it was the disks were just holding up the entire cluster. So we tried with RAID, with RAID systems, EBS RAID. At this time, it was not possible for Elasticsearch to store it on multiple disks. Now it's possible. We also switched to this approach. And we also had problems with the rebalancing. When we lost one node due to timeouts, everything was piling up on another node. It was running out of memory. And we also had not enough memory for the entire node. So the one thing we did is we did a fixed shard allocation before we started filling the cluster. That means just firing empty. So we had an index, as Shay mentioned before. We had time-based indexes. So we had one index per day, and we were adding documents there. So at the beginning, we just created indexes for all the days for 2 or 3 years. They were empty, but they were evenly distributed over all the nodes. Then we started adding the documents. We also wrote the facet that is uncached, because we had to do some calculations it's possible that they run a little bit longer, but they are not filling up the field caches and blow up your cluster. And it was also very, very handy that at some point a new Lucene version was added that used a lot less memory. And these are just the things you see that you need much less memory before, after these things. So it turns out that it's really helpful to follow the mailing lists. So finally, the setup looked like this. We had at the beginning three application servers that were running our Nginx plus OpenRest application, where we did some Lua script for the security and access to the cluster. We also had a memcache there, where we stored some values in memcache and not in Elasticsearch. They were connecting to 6 master nodes. It turned out we have chosen the pretty small, they have not a lot of CPU power instances, but we had 40 instances in each availability zone. That's a total of 120 nodes. Each of them had 8 EBS volumes, so in total about 960 EBS volumes. Pretty small volumes, like 10 gigabyte each. And we were happy because everything was running. We got about 2 gigabytes per second. That's 16 gigabit per second. The node traffic while indexing, it was about 270,000 documents per second that we were able to insert. And the 900 EBS volumes in total made up to about 600,000 reads per second. It still turned out that some volumes didn't behave correctly, like all of them that were above, but it didn't really hurt the cluster. And we were at the point where we had 20 billion documents there and in 2,200 charts, and everything was working fine. So do you think there's a slight problem with this approach? Problem was pretty simple, and it turned out that it is pretty expensive to run this system. But we were proud that we were able to reach this. And the next point was just to cut the costs. and to make this, we were at the point where we decided, okay, it's technically feasible, you can do it, but you need some money. And we were working closer together to cut the cost. And the simplest thing is just to cut the amount of data. If you don't need to store 20 billion of documents, but just 5 billion, then it's easier. So we were finding ways. And because we already had Hadoop infrastructure in front with the MapReduce, we were able to do some calculations on the data before we insert it to Elasticsearch. That's not really expensive. You can spin up some spot instances and eliminate spin. Also leave away some languages that are not interesting for you. And also we made an algorithm that keeps for more interesting users a larger amount of tweets, like Lady Gaga, we keep all the tweets. And for some other users like Bienchen24, we probably keep just 10 tweets of her. And we also decided to go away from the time-based indices because it was not true that they were unevenly distributed. So we had one large index, and we just put everything into one index. And we moved over to dedicated hardware and using SSD disks because I/O was at all the time it was I/O. If you have such a large amount of data, you always need to hit the spindle before you have a result, and it's not possible just to warm up the caches and because it takes really long time. And we were using the same hardware for Elasticsearch and Hadoop, and because of all these changes, the workflow got more complex. So we were using Jenkins, that is triggering all the different steps like getting the data, transforming it, reducing the tweets, kicking out languages, delete old stuff from Elasticsearch, put it in there. So this is running continuously. And the structure looks like now pretty simple. We use S3 to collect all the stuff. We DCP into the HDFS. We do some transformation to Elasticsearch. And then we query against this. We also do some pre-computation directly to Memcache. So pretty complex things that would kill our Elasticsearch classes are pre-calculated and stored in Memcache. And there are some small utilities we're using here. So now we are at the point where we have about the same results. It's a little bit smaller. We're still doing quite some traffic. The I/O. This is really, really interesting. These are 30 servers with SSD disks. One is a SSD disk, one normal SATA disk for HDFS, and it's about 10 times faster than the 120 node cluster we had on Amazon. It's smaller because we have not that much data, but it's much cheaper, and we are easily. So this is just a normal day. This is not even re-indexing. We are easily able to do about 400,000 reads or writes per second. So, I could do the live demo on the API. Right now we have 5 billion documents in the cluster. I just did a hashtag for Berlin buzzwords just before, and it's great to be here. If there is some corpse in the garage without a missing head, we are happy to help. Thanks. Yeah, questions?
I'm really
I'm in time?
No.
Okay.
Thanks for your talk. But 20 minutes are not that much. We are run out of time.
Unfortunately.
I think you can find him here or outside and ask questions now or later. Thank you.
Thank you.